I'm just going to do some preliminaries. I know more people come in. Preliminaries are these. The whole goal of these is to read and look at things in large context. So when we talk about the books, the epistles in the New Testament particularly, they were letters written to particular churches. And those letters are written for people to read. And Paul said in one place, we have this epistle that's to you written in the, read in the church of Laodicea, and have the church, the epistle of Laodiceans written to you, read to you. He wanted them to go in. So remember, they didn't have copies. They didn't get to go home and read it. They just had a parchment that had come to them, and then the pastor or somebody would stand up in front of the congregation and would read it and say, this is what Paul writes by the Holy Ghost to our church. And they would read the epistle, and then people would be blessed. So the whole goal was, back in April, and it's been taking this long to get this ready, but was to take these epistles and let's read them like they were meant to be read. Well, the biggest of them all is Romans. So it's the hardest one to get through in one sitting because it takes a lot of time. But we're going to try to do it quickly. You can take notes. What I'm going to try to do is help to flesh out a lot of the places where he makes mention of things like, as it is written. He'll tell you, as it is written. Well, where was it written? How would you know? Now, for many people who know the Word of God well, they know exactly where it was written, or they understand generally where it was written. Many people today don't have any idea where it was written. So we're going to try to give you references for all those places where it is written. And that will help, I think, just to flesh that out. And then talk about how things fit in the greater context. And what you'll find out is many confusions that people have with the book of Romans come because they take sections out and isolate them, and then try to take their understanding of the world or of other things and bring that into what they see is said there. But that's not the way it should be. What it should be is that you look at that in the context of the letter to the Romans that explains how he got to that point. So when we start out, you're going to want to remember, what did it say in chapter 1 and 2 as we go to chapter 5 and 6 and 7 and 8? And it's going to make things much more clear. Now, Pastor Mark preached a couple of weeks ago on basically Romans chapter 8 for, I don't know how long it was, 4 hours, whatever it was wonderful. It was absolutely amazing on just Romans 8. And he testified, and I believe him, he still wasn't done. So he continued to talk about Romans 8 in subsequent services. That's just Romans 8. We're going to try to do 1 through 16 in less time than that. So what does that tell you? This is an overview. But I think the overview helps you to put it in context so that when you do spend another 3 hours on your own in Romans chapter 8, it'll mean more to you and you'll begin to understand it. The other thing that happens is that in Paul's epistles, he uses the same basic phrases and words and ideas in all of the different epistles in different places and sometimes in different orders. But you can look at all of those and you can understand, oh, so that's what he's talking about. And here's another way to say it that maybe makes it more clear. People will take a single sentence and you can read it and you can hear different things. I heard a story this morning about two guys flying fighter jets in Africa, and they're supposed to go land, and they got the tower contact and said, you can't land. Right? So what would most of us think? Oh, we need to make another pass. We need to check on another runway. We need to figure another place. What did the pilots do? They ejected. Because they couldn't land, they ejected and let their jets fly into the ocean. Okay. Sometimes a sentence is all about context. It's all about what you think they're telling you when they say the sentence. Take the same sentence, you can understand it in different ways. Now, I can't vouch for the truth of the actual story. But my understanding from what I read was that it was actually true. This actually happened. Because people say things, and sometimes we think this is what they mean because we put our own context around it, and it isn't what they mean. And we look at that story and think, that's kind of obvious, but for whatever reason. And obviously, if you're flying a fighter jet, you're not stupid. So somehow, in the context of their culture, that's what they understood. You can't land, therefore they had to come up with a different plan. Okay, eject. That's what they did. Excuse me. All right. So, Romans chapter 1. Similar to what we did with Daniel, we're going to start out by reading. And we're going to hear what the Word of God says. Father, we thank you for your Word. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you lead us and guide us into all the truth, and that the Word of God is the truth. And Lord, so we ask you to lead us and guide us. Father, we can't do anything but by the Holy Spirit. There is nothing we can convey of our own mind. Lord, we thank you for that gift that you give, Lord, that out of our bellies flow rivers of living water, and out of that river of living water, Lord, comes the manifestation of the Spirit to tell and everybody, to touch everybody with the moving of your Spirit, that their understanding would be enlightened and that they would know your Word like they've never known it before. Father, we thank you for it. Lord, we thank you that everything we do is by the Spirit. Lord, that we live in the Spirit, we walk in the Spirit, we have a voice by the Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, Paul's talking to you today. Paul, by the Holy Ghost, is writing to you today. The same anointing that Paul had when he wrote it is still in the words. So you get the anointing of Paul coming to you. Think about that now. He wrote this. Paul, he's writing it to you. But see, he would testify it's the anointing of the Holy Ghost that he had. Same Holy Ghost is given to you so you can receive it. So here's what he says. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the good news of the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scripture. This is a promise of God. The gospel is fulfillment of the promise of God. Very important. Concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. We all know he was a descendant of David through his mother Mary. You can trace her genealogy in Luke, all the way back to Adam, but certainly through David. And declared, he was declared to be the Son of God with power. We knew who he was because of his power, the manifestation. That's why Nicodemus came to him by night and said, no man can do the works that you do except God be with him. There was a manifestation of power. According to the Spirit of holiness, hear this, the power is linked to the holiness. He had the power according to the Spirit of holiness. He was set apart unto the gospel of God. Just as Paul is testifying, I'm set apart to the gospel of God. By the resurrection from the dead. The biggest power, everything hinges on this. I saw another thing just this morning. I get messages from some people that they are always trying to link science and the Bible. It's just interesting stuff to read to me. And some of it I like, some of it I'm not so sure about, but the guy got up there and said, look, the fundamental thing is, and if we're going to try to prove the existence of God, there's only one thing that matters. Jesus rose from the dead, or he didn't. And I was like, amen, that is absolutely true. Because Jesus rising from the dead is the number one thing. Paul said, if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, we're yet in our sins, our faith is vain, what's the point? Let's give it up, okay? Jesus rose from the dead. We know that. So this resurrection from the dead, he testifies. So right in the beginning of this book is this testimony of what this book is about. This is what it's about. It's about the gospel. It's about Jesus. It's about the Son of being sons of God. It's about the Spirit of holiness. It's about the resurrection of the dead. And by him, we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith. And that's another key one. You can mark that. You're going to see at the end of the book, he uses the same phrase, obedience to the faith. This is what he's asking us to do. And you'll hear this throughout the entire book, obedience to the faith. It won't be said in those words, but that's what he's talking about. among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. So I'm saying to you, all of you, you're the called of Jesus Christ. We all know that to be true. He's writing to all that be at Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First thing, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For my God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request, if by any means, now at length, I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end you may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren. There are many times, oftentimes, I purposed to come unto you, but I was hindered from coming. That's what it means, I was let hitherto. It's not words that we usually use. That I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Paul was very desirous to go to Rome. He eventually went to Rome. We'll hear later in the book about how he's intending to go to Jerusalem. We know what happened when he went to Jerusalem. So this book was written before he went to Jerusalem. He said, I got to go take some stuff to Jerusalem first. And then we know he got arrested, he got imprisoned, he got held there for a long time, eventually got sent to Rome. So he did get to go. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. Greek is stand in for any Gentile here. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Besides, I mentioned obedience to the faith. Here's the premise of the whole book. The just shall live by faith. This is it. Where is that found originally? Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. That's where it begins. You can go read the context of that. You can go study that out. We don't have time today. But Habakkuk 2:4, the just shall live by faith. Very important. Notice what he says. The righteousness of God is revealed. Righteousness. People want to believe to unrighteousness. We don't believe unto unrighteousness. We believe to righteousness. The righteousness of God is revealed here. The just live by faith. The rest of the book is going to take this premise and it's going to flesh it out. It's going to keep on coming. Four. Here's the reason. Why is the righteousness revealed? Because the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has showed it unto them, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. They are understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Now, people use this to mean a lot of different things, but let's understand this. Nobody has an excuse. The word of God has been preached. The testimony of God, the Creator, is in existence in everything that you can see. There are numerous testimonies of people in every culture, every place, every situation, who have seen what is around them and have said, I want to know the God who made all of this. They do. Excuse me. But because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, and they were not thankful. You know, it's simply just being thankful. Lord, I thank you for the sun rising this morning. Thank you for the air I breathe. I mean, it's just simple things. But they became vain in their imaginations. They began to imagine something other than the things that God had made. Their foolish heart was darkened. Why? Because they knew God, but they decided not to acknowledge him as God. And so they became fools. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Right? They professed themselves to be wise, they became fools, and they changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, to birds, four-footed beasts, and creeping things. I mean, goodness. In our culture, we have a hard time understanding why people would bow down to a carved idol of an eagle or something. I mean, it doesn't mean anything to us. But these people got so foolish, that's what they did. Okay? We have other subtle things we put in place. Our wisdom, our knowledge, our understanding, our education, our whatever that we put in place of the Word of God. They don't look quite as silly to us, but they're just as silly to God. Anyway. Wherefore? I want to comment on wherefore. You're going to see in these writings many times, wherefores and therefores. And you always want to ask what they're there for. There's a reason. Knowing this fact, that there has been people, they knew God, they turned their back on God, they walked away from him. As he's staying here, they gave themselves to idols. Wherefore, because of this, God also gave them up to uncleanness. Remember, the love of God is such that he is not willing that anybody perish. He wasn't willing that anybody perish in Sodom and Gomorrah. He wasn't willing. But they did so evil that he finally had to come down and just wipe it out. He could not allow it to stand. God is not willing. He's constantly reaching out to people, continuously reaching, saying, come, 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 come. His call is come. Let the Spirit say come. Let the bride say come. Let all that hear say come, come, come. This is God's heart, right? So wherefore God, because they refused him, they just refused him in their rebellious heart, he had to give them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own heart, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creation or the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. What does this sound like? And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves the recompense of their error, which was meet, which was appropriate. I mean, if that isn't a testimony against our culture today, that is as clear as it gets. Women with women, men with men is the result of God giving people over unto uncleanness. Of God, them so rejecting God that he finally has to just turn them over and let them go. And this is what it results in, the horror of it all. People act like it's just another lifestyle. It isn't just another lifestyle. It's absolute bondage to debauchery. It is worse than torture in a Vietnamese prison camp, but they'll testify that they're having a good time. They're not. They are some of the most miserable, pain-filled, angry people you will ever meet, because inside they have no God. This is the end of it. This scripture right here, when this whole thing came down some weeks ago from the Supreme Court, this is all that I could see in my mind. God just kept reminding me of the scripture. Men with men working that which is unseemly. Even the women doing it. It's just losing all sense of godliness. It is so far beyond bad that you can't even express it. And Paul writes here going, that's the end of sin. It's the end of it. There's a lot of sin. That's the end of it. And verse 28, he said, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, remember that's hearkening back, they knew him as God, they didn't want to know him as God, they pushed him away, God gave them to a reprobate mind to do the things which are not convenient, things that are not good for you. Being filled, what were they filled with? Unrighteousness, all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affections, implacable, unmerciful. That's a long list. There are a lot of other lists that you can find in the Bible. Colossians 3, Galatians 5, 1 Corinthians 6, 1 Peter 2. You can go look them up. These are all places that have very similar lists. This is not an unusual thing. The Bible is full of this. It tells you what sin is. What he's saying is that when you refuse God, this is what you get in exchange. This is your lot, because you said, I don't want what you got, I'll take this. Just like the prodigal son said, Father, I don't want to be in your house, I'm going to do my own thing. Seemed good for a while, and then suddenly it became much less than good. That's what happens. Those things are not good things. They're horrible things. And so this list is here. So let's emphasize this one more time. Homosexuality is sort of the end of it all. But every one of these things is here. And here is the judgment of God. Who, knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only the ones that do the same, but ones that have pleasure in them that do them. Wow. That's amazing. You can take that and you can do a lot with it. You can begin to understand that if I'm taking pleasure in a movie that's glorifying sin, am I then under the judgment of God? Really, that's what it says. This is really the culture that we live in is filled with all of these things. And it's a hard thing for people to understand how much God hates sin. But notice how it got here. They refused God, and therefore he had to turn them over to get what they was right for them. This is what they wanted. Okay. My son, you want to leave the house? Go ahead. Here you go. Go. See where you end up. Doesn't end well. And that's what happens. And then first chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore. So we ask again the question, what is the therefore, therefore? Because of this, you are inexcusable. Oh man, whoever you are that judges. Oh no, you mean we're not supposed to judge people? Let's listen to the rest. For wherein you judge another, you condemn yourself, for you that judge do the same things. Wow, that's amazing. So what is the best way to stop any judgment from sin coming? Get everybody convinced that they're all sinners. Because what the scripture says is, if you're doing the same things, you can't go judging people. Just like Jesus said, get the beam out of your eye before you go looking for the speck in somebody else's, right? But see, they don't remember that you're supposed to get it out. They just want to testify you got one. And since everybody's got one, you can't judge me, right? That's what he says. But we are sure, we're sure of something. The judgment of God is according to truth against them that commit such things. So it doesn't matter about me. You want to testify against me? You want to point your finger at me? You want to point out all the things you think I did wrong? You want to try to tell me I can't judge you? Yeah, but God can and God will, regardless of your opinion. So when I testify of the word of God, when I speak the word of God, the God's judging you. God's judgment is just and true against these. And you think, oh man, you judge them which do such things and you do the same, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? The first testimony of John the Baptist, the first testimony of Jesus, the first message the disciples were taught to preach, repent, repent, repent. That's what it's about. One of the things we're going to find Paul does, he concludes everybody under sin. Why? Because there are people who thought, I don't need a redeemer. And we'll talk about that. So, but after your hardness and your impenitent heart, you treasure up unto yourself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Because you refuse to repent, that's what it says here, your heart is hard and impenitent. You refuse to repent. That is the worst thing. You need to repent. That's why Jesus said, repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's right here. God, the judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds, to those who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he gives you, rewards you with eternal life. But unto them that are contentious, do not obey the truth or the word of God. They obey unrighteousness. Here's what they get: indignation and wrath. I thank God I'm saved from wrath. Tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that does evil, of the Jew first, also of the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace to every man that works good, to the Jew first, also to the Gentile. For there's no respect to persons with God. Notice what he said there. Who works good? I need to work good. How do I get saved? I repent. What does salvation result in? Good works. We're going to see that. For as many have sinned without the law, they will perish without the law. As many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law are justified. For when the Gentiles, which do not have the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves. They show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, that their thoughts, the meanwhile, accusing or else excusing one another. There is a testimony that the law of God is written in their hearts. Where is that testimony? Where do we understand that? God's testified, I will write my law in your heart. I will put it within you. I will put it in there. I'll write it on the fleshly tables of the heart. It's another place. God does this. Who does he do it for? Those with a penitent heart. Those with a heart that gives itself to saying, Lord, forgive me. Wash me clean. So wonderful. Verse 16, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. God will judge men and even their secrets. The things you think nobody knows, God knows. He will judge them all. That judgment is important. This is the first thing that we're getting to in Paul's work through Romans. Is, remember, we're talking about justification by faith. That's what we're going to be talking about all through this thing. First thing we have to understand, there is a judgment coming. There is a wrath coming against all sin and unrighteousness, for the Jew first and also for the Gentile. Nobody's excluded. There is a wrath coming. Who can step out of the wrath? Who can be saved from the wrath? Those who repent. That's it. Verse 17, behold, here's Paul talking to them. You are called a Jew, and you rest in the law, and you make your boast of God. And you know his will, and you approve the things that are more excellent, and you're instructed out of the law. You are confident that you yourself are a guide of the blind, a light of them which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which hast the form of knowledge and the truth in the law. You therefore, which teaches another, do you not teach yourself? You that preach a man should not steal, do you steal? You that say a man should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, do you commit sacrilege? Like we were saying earlier, they don't bow down to a carving of an eagle, but they do other things that they exalt above the word of God. Thou that makest thy boast of the law, through breaking the law, do you dishonor God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written, for circumcision verily profiteth if you keep the law, but if you be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. And that place where it's written, if this thing will pop up right, it's Ezekiel 36, I believe. But my, there it is. 36, 20 and 23. You can go read it. I don't have time to read all of it. But he basically testifies about them that the name of God is blasphemed amongst the Gentiles because of the sin that you do, O Jew. You say you represent God. For circumcision very profits if you keep the law. But if you're a breaker, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore, verse 26 of chapter 2, if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness of the law, the Gentile, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge you, who by the letter and circumcision dost transgress the law? For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Now this is worth talking about a little bit. Again, I'm having a little trouble with my notes because they're supposed to pop up, but they're not popping up. Circumcision of the heart is not a new idea for Paul. It's not. It's testified of in other places in the New Testament, but it's also testified of in Deuteronomy. What I was trying to do is look up the exact scripture, which I don't have. It is Deuteronomy 10:16. Says this, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. So in the law itself, Deuteronomy is part of the Pentateuch. It is the main piece of the law of God. And in there it tells them, circumcise your heart. Heart needs to be circumcised. It's also in Colossians 2:11, Philippians 3:3, where Paul talks about this. It's important to understand. What he's saying is, outward show doesn't get the job done. A Jew, a person of God, is one who is one inwardly, whose heart is circumcised. What is he trying to do? He's trying to conclude that everybody's under sin. So that once he concluded everybody's under sin, we conclude that the way of salvation for everybody is the same. That's really what we're trying to do. Chapter 3. He has a digression a little bit here. What advantage then is it to be a Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? There's a big advantage. It says much every way. It's saying there's a big advantage. Chiefly because unto them were committed the oracles of God or the word of God. I mean, do you think it's an advantage to have the word of God? Absolutely, it's an advantage. For what if some didn't believe? What if some of the Jews didn't believe? Does their unbelief make the faith of God of no effect? God forbid. The first of the many, God forbids in Romans. You know, God forbid, basically every time I see this, I think, absolutely not, that's completely crazy. That's what I hear when I hear God forbid. So, if they didn't believe, does that mean that God's faith is no effect? God forbid. Yea, let God be true, but every man a liar. As it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome when you are judged. And I don't know why. There it is. Psalms 51:4. As is written in Psalms 51:4, that you mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome when you are judged. But if our unrighteousness commends the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous to take vengeance? I speak as a man, he says. Here's the question. If what we're saying here is that our unrighteousness testifies of the righteousness of God, why does God get mad at us? We're helping him out. And that's really what he's saying. God forbid. Then how shall God judge the world? He's going to judge the world, and we already heard the difference. Those who by patient continuance and well-doing get eternal life, and those who store up unto themselves wrath unto the day of wrath, they get eternal death, right? there's going to be a difference between people. There's going to be people on this side. There's going to be people on that side. There's not going to be three sides. There's not going to be multiple groups. It's going to be one group over here, one group over here. It's very, very clear. The judgment of God is one of the foundational doctrines of the Bible. In Hebrews, when he talks about the foundational doctrines, one of the ones he talks about is eternal judgment. You got to get this. There's an eternal judgment coming. It will judge people, and you will be on one side or you will be on the other. And believe me, you want to be on the righteousness side. You do not want to be on the wrath side. Okay, God's going to judge the world. So he doesn't want everybody to continue in sin. People say, well, maybe God's sin's a good thing because it exalts God. No, no, never. For if the truth of God has more abounded unto my through my lie unto his glory, why am I judged a sinner? I've just given glory to God by my sin. That's what he's saying. And not rather, as we be slanderously reported, and some affirm that we say, let us do evil that good may come. The people who say that, their damnation is just. So he's defending himself against critics who say that he says that let's do evil so good can come. That is not what he says. He's saying that yes, our sin, the glory of God still manifested, but the whole goal is to take the sin away. We're going to get there. What then? Are we better than they are? No, in no wise, for we have before proved, both Jews and Gentiles, they are all under sin. This was important. What did Jesus testify to the Pharisees, who were the most outwardly righteous people of their day? You said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. And he's testified to them, you are whitewashed sepulchers. He said, you tithe of your mint and your anise and your cumin. And then you avoid the weightier matters of the law, love and justice. He says, you put those aside. You despise people. You despise people in need and you mistreat them. And you store up unto yourself wrath, thinking you're righteous because you're keepers of the law, but you don't keep the whole law because you steal and you commit adultery and you murder and you do things with your mouth and you put on the show as if you're so righteous, as if your righteousness would attain to the righteousness of God. It doesn't. Anyway, I digress. So we have concluded. So this is the conclusion that he makes. He starts out this chapter with, what advantage is there to be a Jew? Yeah, there's a great advantage, but here's a problem. When you are self-righteous, you can't receive the righteousness of God. You just can't. So as it is written, there is none righteous. Now, they're going to have a long thing here where he's going to run through a whole bunch of scriptures. So I tried to write down a whole bunch of the scriptures that apply to this section. So if anybody's taking notes, you want to write them down, here's what they are. Psalms 14, 2 to 3. Well, hold on. Those trying to write. Psalms 14, 2 to 3. Psalms 52, 2 to 4. Ecclesiastes 7, 20. And the second section will be Psalms 5, 9 through 10. Psalms 10, 7. Psalms 36, 1 through 2. Psalms 140, verse 3. And then Isaiah 59, 7 through 8. So if you go and you read all of those, you'll see the pieces of this thing that Paul's about to do. He's going to start saying, as it's written, a whole bunch of things. So let's hear what he said. There is none righteous, no, not one. There's none that understands. There's none that seeks after God. They are all gone out of the way. They're altogether become unprofitable. There's none that does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Wow. That's just a testimony against the Jew particularly, but really everybody, in part of this conclusion, everybody's under sin. Remember, that's what we're getting to. You can't be justified by faith. If you don't first understand, you're under sin. That's what's going to happen. Verse 19, now we know that what things soever the law says, it says to them that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. This is a very salient scripture for later. So I have it heavily marked in my thing here that the stuff of the law speaks to those that are under the law. Why? That every mouth may be stopped. Everyone boasting of themselves. What do we see of Job? What do we see of Daniel? What do we see of John? What do we see of many others? They get into the presence of God, and what do? They fall down and they cannot speak. Job said, I have spoken, yea, spoken twice, and I will not speak again. You know, I'll put my hand over my mouth. So what he's saying is every mouth may be stopped. When you come into the presence of God, all your self-righteousness, all your sense of what you've accomplished is as absolutely nothing in his presence. That's the point. For man to exalt himself in any way, I am special because I'm an inch taller than you or whatever. Whatever the difference, dichotomy we may try to make, I try to judge you and me and find a place where I'm better than you. And you might try to find a place where you're better than me. All of that, it comes of evil. It's just of evil. None of that is the kingdom of God. And what he says here is when you get in the presence of God, you will not talk. You will shut your mouth. You will recognize that all the world is guilty before him. The whole world. And we're going to talk later. Paul's going to explain to us later how that all happened. Therefore, here's another therefore. Therefore, what's the conclusion of this section? By the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Notice the word justified. What are we talking about? What is justification by faith? You are not justified by your works. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. The law comes, says you shall not covet, and you recognize, I coveted, I'm sinful. Right? Okay. Now, the righteousness of God without the law is manifested and is witnessed by the law and the prophets. He's saying there is a righteousness to be had. We've just concluded there's none righteous. But there's a righteousness to be had, and it is a righteousness that is testified of by the law and by the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. There's no difference between the Jew and the Gentile. Everybody's under sin. Everybody needs a redeemer. This righteousness comes by the faith of Jesus Christ. And it's unto all and upon all that believe. For there is no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. People take that scripture and say, well, everybody's a sinner. Everybody sinned. Everybody sinned. Absolutely. That's true. But I receive, because I believe, I receive the righteousness of God. Not a fake righteousness. Not a diploma of righteousness that doesn't mean anything. But real righteousness. And that's what we're going to talk about. So, because we're justified freely by his grace. He comes and the grace of God is manifested that brings salvation and testifies we're supposed to live godly and soberly and righteously. Titus 2:11, right? Justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God or the mercy of God. In his mercy, he concludes everybody's under sin, but he gives a way for us to receive righteousness, a real righteousness that he gives unto us. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believes in Jesus. Justification by faith. Not fake justification, real justification. He gives it to us because we believe in Jesus. This is it. I mean, this is the gospel. This is wonderful, wonderful news. So you see here, people take these scriptures and they mess with them because they get out of the context. This whole context is righteousness, not sin. But until you understand you are a sinner and you need to be redeemed, you cannot receive his righteousness. Because when you stand in your own self-righteousness, you do not need him to give you righteousness, and therefore you will not receive it, and therefore you are yet in your sins and you will die. That's the problem. Okay. Let's keep seeing what Paul has to say here. Where is boasting then? Where is boasting? It's excluded. No boasting. By law of works? No, by the law of faith. The law of faith excludes all boasting. Remember we said, when you get in the presence of God, you will have nothing to boast of. None of us will stand up and say, look what I did. None of us will do that, I guarantee you. Therefore, here's what's it there for? We conclude, here's the conclusion. A man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, he is the God of the Gentiles also. Seeing it is one God which will justify the circumcision by faith and the uncircumcision through faith. Do we then make void the law of God? God forbid. Yes, we establish the law. And then he's going to talk about that. So it's been, well, let me do most of four here. Paul writes, what shall we say then that Abraham, our father, is pertaining to the flesh is found? What is he talking about? Abraham is the father of the Jews. He's also the father of everyone who believes on Jesus. Okay? He's the first fruits in a sense. For if Abraham were justified by works, he has something to glory about. Of course, not before God. We all agree. But still, he would have something to glory if he was justified by works. For what says the scripture? Abraham believed God and was counted to him for righteousness. That's Genesis 15 something. I think it might be 5 or 6 or something. 6. Abraham believed God and was counted to him for righteousness. Now to him that works is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. So if I work for you, we agree, I'm gonna work for you for a day and you're gonna pay me $20, then you have a debt to me that you owe me because I worked. That's what he's talking about. So if justification is by works, then God owes it to you, right? God doesn't owe you nothing. That's the conclusion. But to him that works not, but believes on the one who justifies those who are ungodly. Wow. His faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also describes the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes righteousness without works. That's in Psalms 32, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Wow, David testified to this stuff. Comes this blessedness then upon the circumcision only or upon the uncircumcision as well? We say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How was it then that it was reckoned? When he was circumcised or not? Not when he was circumcised, but when he was uncircumcised. Excuse me. Abraham was called righteous for believing God, and he wasn't yet circumcised. He received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had before he was circumcised, that he might be the father of all those that believed, whether they're circumcised or not, but though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. He's the father of the faith. He's the first that we have testimony of that it illustrates for us justification by faith. He was called righteous before God, called the friend of God. It's amazing. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had when he was uncircumcised. For the promise that he should be heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law. Remember, the law didn't even exist at that time. But through the righteousness of faith. Abraham believed God, it was counted to him for righteousness. That is paramount to understanding Romans. For if they which are of the law are heirs, if you're of the law and you're an heir of God, then faith is made void. If you keep the law to obtain unto this righteousness, then faith is worthless. And the promise is made of no effect. Remember, God promised to Abraham, I will make you a father of many nations, and salvation will come through you. Because the law works wrath. For where there's no law, there's nothing to transgress against. See, the problem with sin was that men were sinners and they did not know it. We just digress here to kind of summarize some of this for you. Men did not know it. They lived in what they thought was best. Let your conscience be your guide. I've seen that turn out very badly many times. People doing what seemed good to them. Well, I think this is good, so I'm going to do it. It wasn't good. This was the problem of man. So a law has to come so that men can see. You're not supposed to commit adultery. Well, why not? And you hear it today. What harm is it? Who did it hurt? If we mutually agree, what's the problem? Transgressing the law of God, doing what you think is right, doing what's right in your own eyes, right? Because the law, verse 15, works wrath, for where no law is, there's no transgression. People don't know. Therefore, this justification, it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but that which is also of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. We had to conclude everybody under sin. We had to then understand that everybody can be made righteous by faith, be justified by faith. As it is written, and that's Genesis 17, I have made thee a father of many nations. Notice when he testified to Abraham, he wasn't excluding all the nations. I made you a father of many nations. Before him whom he believed, even God, who quickens the dead and calls those things which are not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. Remember the story of Abraham. God told him when he's about 75, leave everything, follow me, go to the place I'm telling you about, and I'm going to make you a father of many nations. He lived for another 24 years, and he and Sarah had no child. They finally had an Ishmael, which didn't turn out so well. You can read about that in Galatians. Didn't turn out so good. But eventually, God came and said, here comes the promise. When what? Against hope. There was no hope for Abraham. Sarah was barren. She couldn't have kids anyway. Abraham was so old, he couldn't make them. They were just without hope. There was no possible way for them to have children. It just couldn't happen. But against that, against all expectation in the natural, he still believed God. That is faith. He believed God. He heard the word of God and he believed it no matter what his senses testified to him. Did not consider it. He's not weak in faith. He did not consider his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old. Neither did he consider the fact that Sarah was barren, the deadness of her womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. Isn't that amazing? And we get all upset over one downturn? Something doesn't quite go the way we want, and our faith is overthrown. God must not be for me. I mean, or whatever it might be. This is what we do. It's sad. What we want to learn here is how to have faith in God. And being fully persuaded that what God had promised, God was able also to perform. And therefore, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Wow. He believed God. What's he talking about? I've concluded everybody's under sin. We got that straight. Jew and Gentile, all under sin. I have now concluded that Abraham is the father of faith. He's the father of many nations. He's the father of everyone who comes to God because they learn to believe God. And then he's telling you about what did Abraham do to believe God. He believed him against every word of man, against every testimony of science. If we had scientifically tested Abraham and Sarah, they could not have children. Okay? Just think of it that way. They went to the doctor. They were infertile. He didn't work. Everything was not working. Done. Right? Now, verse 20, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also to whom it shall be imputed if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. Here's that resurrection thing again. Who was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Wow. He paid the price for my offenses and was raised from the dead to bring that justification that I have by faith. And having it by faith doesn't mean you don't have it. Having it by faith means you have it. Just as Abraham had the promise of God and he knew he would receive what God had promised. And Abraham, you know, understand this. There were two parts to this. Abraham received Isaac, a fulfillment of the promise, absolutely. But he's really only the testimony of the real promise, which was the justification by faith that would then be allowed to come to everybody, both Jews and Gentiles. Abraham is the father of me, even though I probably don't have a drop of Jewish blood in me. He's my father because he's the father of faith for everyone who will believe. So his belief, his faith in God, his understanding the promise and believing it is like the door that was open so that Jesus could come and bring to me the justification that I have because I believe God the same way that Abraham did. Anyway, so we finished chapter 4. I wanted to get through 5 by the first hour, so I'm already behind. But Lord knows, we're going to make it. Because chapter 5 starts with a therefore. Therefore, being justified by faith, us, included both Jews and Gentiles, all of us, justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's an important thing. Isn't it wonderful to have peace with God, to know he doesn't hate you? No, he's not against you. To know that he loves you. I mean, have peace with God. By whom also, through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand. Titus 2:11, I mentioned it earlier, is one of the most salient verses on grace. It says this, the grace of God that brings salvation appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Okay? Many people have taken this word grace and they've turned it into something else. A lot of terms for it. People talk greasy grace and what else, all that kind of stuff. But they testify that the grace of God is such that, see, blessed is the man to whom God doesn't impute sin. It doesn't mean you still have sin. God just doesn't count it. Which is nonsense. Okay, completely. That's what we're going to be talking about. So he says here, we have received peace with God by faith. We've been justified by faith, and we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand. I live in grace not to excuse my sin. I live in grace to walk soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Okay, that's what grace came for. Grace didn't come to cover up my sin. It came to help me to stand without it now that I've been made just by faith. Because remember, we concluded at the end of chapter 4, he was delivered for our offenses. He paid the price, and he was raised for our justification. Right? And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory even in tribulations. And also knowing that tribulation works patience, and patience works experience, and experience works hope. Pastor Mark will talk about hope, and he'll put in expectation, because he's recognizing that in our modern world, we've taken the word hope and we've ruined it. So he understands that when you say hope, people don't hear hope like they heard in 1611. The word hope means fully persuaded of receiving that which you have been told you're going to get. So I have hope for an inheritance. Charles Dickens wrote a book called Great Expectations, which was the hope. But he recognized even then that people had lost the sense of the word hope. So when you see hope, Pastor Mark translated it expectation, and it's good. But I just use the word here hope, but I want you to understand that I totally agree. What it means is full expectation. It's mine, okay? It's mine. So, and hope does not make you ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So now what we're talking about is the fullness of this salvation. When you are justified by faith, you don't just go, okay, I'm justified by faith. Great. I think I'll sit down, take my ease. Everything will be good. That's not what we're talking about. Because of that justification by faith, we received access into the grace to where we stand. And now we rejoice in the hope, the expectation of the glory of God, both now and in the future. Now, in my spirit, the glory of God rises up from my innermost being and comes flowing out of me, and then my body will be glorified. I'm still waiting for that one, right? And verse 5, hope makes not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. It is the Holy Ghost that has been given to us in the grace of God to stand in this justification that we have received. We've been given a new life. When I was born of my parents, it was over for me then. I was dead in my sins. I was born in sin, shaped in iniquity. There was nothing I could do. And then to compound the problem, I went and committed my own sin to double down on the problem. That's really what happened. I had no hope. But when I was born of God, now I receive the life of God, and inside, in my soul, in my spirit, quickening my mortal body, I have received the life of God. Do you see the difference? Do you see what born again really means? I've been made brand new. And one of the big parts of this, the love of God has been put in here. Both my knowledge of how much he loved me and how much I can love others, because the Holy Ghost is given to me. It's the Holy Ghost who brings the animation to this life that I have received, okay? For when we were yet without strength, so when I was still dead in my trespasses and sin, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. We heard that earlier, where for the ungodly he died. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood. He said, look, he died for me when I was a sinner, but even more, now that I've been made righteous, now that I've been made justified by belief in him, by his blood that he shed, we are saved from wrath through him. This is so important. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. I always put in the word reconciliation. We've been reconciled to God. We have received the reuniting of ourselves together. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, so that all have sinned. Remember I told you I was in trouble because I was born in iniquity. Then I sinned to make it even worse, right? Skip down to verse 18. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. Now, why did I skip? Because there's a big parenthesis here. And people often get lost in the parenthesis, and they miss what's being said. So I want to say it again. One man sinned into the world. Death came because of sin. And death passed upon all men. And therefore, all men sinned to keep the cycle going. Verse 18, therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to be condemned, even so, by the righteousness of one, Christ Jesus, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So in the same way that Adam sinned and caused us all to be sinners, Jesus lived a righteous life and died for us to cause us all to be righteous. Now let's look at the parenthesis that we skipped. Because what Paul does here is he's fleshing out this argument. And it's difficult wording in English. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there's no law. In other words, we heard it late earlier, you don't even know you're a sinner. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that did not sin after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that is to come. Notice Paul, he can't just stop talking about the fact Jesus makes this all better. But Adam was the first Adam. Jesus was the last Adam. Second, people will say, fine, but he's also the last. There ain't going to be another, right? And just like Adam was the father of sin for all of those that are his descendants, Jesus is the father of righteousness for everyone who will believe on him. All right. So death reigned from Adam to Moses, even though there was no law. And people were doing that which was right in their own eyes. And they didn't even know, a lot of them. They claimed ignorance. But see, that's why Paul began the whole thing. Remember, because the creation declares his glory and they're not ignorant. They knew. But when they knew God, they chose to reject him. And therefore, they were given over to even greater depths of depravity. All right. He's the figure. Verse 15. Now, listen to this wording. We're going to take this carefully. But not as the offense. It's a weird, strange way of saying, in a different way, it's not like the offense. The offense was of one to many sins. Not as the offense, so is the free gift. So how are they different? For if through the offense of one, many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, abounds to many. Okay? And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation. But the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. Notice, one man sinned, everybody became sinners. But all of that sin, Jesus came and made them all righteous. Who are we righteous in? Christ Jesus. We're going to get to it later and testify the fact your life is not your own. Your life is in Christ Jesus, or you do not have life. It must be in Christ Jesus. So how many men stand righteous before God? One, Christ Jesus. And all of us are brought in with him. You see the difference? And that's where this wording gets tough, because what Paul's saying is there's a difference between the two. They're likened to one another, but there's a little bit of a difference in the way in which it works. And it's important that we understand this, what he's really trying to convey, which is that if you're going to be righteous, it's all in Christ Jesus. That's the fundamental point here. Just like in Adam, we all died. Christ Jesus, we can all be made alive, but we go from many sins unto one new man. And there we went from one man to many sinners. That's the not as the offense part. Do you see why it says that? And not as it was by one that sinned. That was weird. Gotta find myself again. So is the gift, that's verse 16, for the judgment, for the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses to justification. My computer just keeps flipping it the opposite of the way I'm reading, which is really strange. So I'm going to try to lock it so it didn't do that anymore. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace, just like we talked about over there, abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. We are all in him. People say, you're not righteous. I'm in him. He's righteous. My life is in him. In him I live and move and have my being. Everything that I have comes from him. All my justification, all my righteousness. Jesus, you are all my wisdom. You're my righteousness. You're my sanctification. You're everything to me. That's who Jesus is. Okay? So that's what that parenthesis. People get lost in this. Because the wording is strange. So hopefully as you read it, again, you'll be able to understand that you do take 12 and 18 to understand the basic thrust of the point. 13 through 17 is fleshing out this very important point. That you sinned, yes. You were worthy of death, yes. Christ died for the ungodly, yes. Now we live in him. He didn't give you life so you could then go out and do your own thing. That's not how it works. Adam gave you death, and then men went out and did their own thing. And they doubled down on stupid, and they ended up in homosexuality and then all of these other sins. That's chapter one. But Jesus came, gave us life, and now we stand not as independent, Pastor Mark, somebody used the term independent combat units. We are not independent combat units. We're all in him. In him. That's the point of the parenthesis. You're in him. So that's why it ends with the gift of righteousness reigns in life by one, Jesus Christ. He is all of my righteousness. I have no righteousness in myself. I receive through faith the righteousness that he has. I've received. Therefore, as by offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Wait a minute. We concluded there's none righteous. No, not one. There's none that understands. There is no redeemer. There is no justifier. There's no one to stand before God righteous. Yes, there is. His name is Jesus. And when I stand in him, I receive of him all the righteousness that he has. That's amazing. This is so important. And most people, believe it or not, most people don't know anything about this. They don't understand these things. They've never heard it. It's never penetrated their spirit by the Holy Spirit. They've not been taught that all their life is in Christ Jesus. They go about doing their own thing, choosing to do what they want to do, thinking that whatever they do is a good idea. It's not. So we're made righteous. So when somebody tells you there's none righteous, no, not one, say, amen, I'm righteous. Wait a minute, in Christ Jesus. Oh, does that mean that when you sin, it doesn't count? No, that's not what I mean. But we're going to get to that some more. Moreover, now in addition to this, above and beyond this, the law entered. Now where's the law come into this? It entered that the offense might abound. God wanted to show men their sins, just like the Holy Ghost comes to convince you of sin. See, I don't need the law to convince me of sin anymore. I have the Holy Ghost. He comes to convince men of sin. Why? So that he can tell them, ha, 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 you got sin? No. So he can tell you, repent. Get it right. Come under it. Get the blood to wash it away. Put your trust in God. Put your faith in God. I'll make you right. Bring you back into the fold, and you'll be within the life of Christ Jesus. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. God's power to set men free from sin abounds even greater. When the law came, there was a greater testimony of God. And there was a place for people to come and run to where they could receive the righteousness of faith. David received the righteousness of faith, same as Abraham did. And so did many, many others in Israel. Elijah thought he was the last one, and God said, I got 7,000. You know, he was boasting in 7,000. That's how hard it is. But verse 21, that as sin has reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness. People say, I don't have righteousness, but grace reigns in my life. Nonsense. Complete nonsense. Grace reigns through righteousness. Whose righteousness? Jesus' righteousness. Where? In me. He's in me, I'm in him, we're together. Okay? Unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Same as that conclusion of the parentheses. It's all in Jesus. If you can get that one thing out of this, if you can understand that it's the life of Jesus in you and you in his life, if you can get that, you are on your way. Because the Holy Ghost will take that and manifest it and magnify it and cause you to begin to understand these things. Everything that goes on is by the Holy Ghost. We're going to get to that. Verse 6, chapter 6, verse 1. So what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Because remember, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Well, it's the same kind of argument as we talked about earlier. Well, if my sin abounded to the glory of God, why don't I just keep sinning so God can get glory? No, God forbid. Are you absolutely crazy? He says the same thing here. Do we continue in sin so grace can abound? Are you absolutely crazy? God forbid. This is nuts. No, if you're dead to sin, how are you going to live any longer therein? Now, this is the first time he brings up this concept of dead to sin. It's sort of hidden in what he's talked about, but you're going to see much more about that. Do you not understand? Do you not know that so many of us, as we're baptized into Jesus Christ, we're baptized into his death? See, remember, I was made one with him, justified in him. When I came in to his life, I was baptized with him, baptized into Jesus Christ. I lost my own life and I got his, right? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. This is important. Well, that's how we're supposed to walk. What do we stand in? The grace that's given unto us. The Holy Ghost that's been shed abroad in our heart. So that we can walk in the life of Christ Jesus. That's why he says, come, take up your cross, follow me. Go do what I do. Act like I act, say what I say. For if we've been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and henceforth we should not serve sin. That's our old life. For he that is dead is freed from sin. When you die, sin's over. But if you die in your sins, guess where you go? Into judgment. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, does not die anymore. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin one time. But in that he lives unto God, and we can imply forever. Forever he lives. Do I live in him? Yes. So therefore, where do I live? Eternally, with him. Likewise, reckon ye yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Understand it. Reckon, receive it. Believe it by faith. That's what it means when you say reckon yourselves. Well, how do I reckon myself? I don't understand. By faith, I believe the word of God and I receive that which he gives me by faith. And because of that, justification by faith, I receive grace and the Holy Ghost. Simple. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in the lust thereof. It is your job. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God, as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. So grace is not covering up my sin. It's empowering me to live without the sin. And it's teaching me how to yield myself to the things of God and not to the things of sin. That's what it's teaching me. Isn't it wonderful? What then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? Are you absolutely nuts? No, that is not what I'm saying. God forbid. Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants you are to whom you obey. When you yield yourself to sorrow and sadness and whining and complaining and upset and anger and all envy and whatever, you're an instrument of unrighteousness. You don't realize it, but you're being used by the devil to wage war against God, and you don't even know it. But if you yield your members unto righteousness, now you're a weapon of God to be used against the enemies of God. Those enemies reign over people that we know and people that we see. They reign over them. And if we go as instruments of righteousness, we can begin to defeat those enemies that reign over them and set them free. But we digress again. What then? So, verse 16, last half, you are his servants, you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Again, the idea that we can't be righteous, nonsense. Obey, just obey. But God be thanked, you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. Wow, that's good. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh, for as you have yielded your members, servants to uncleanness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members, servants to righteousness unto holiness. Wow. Be ye holy, for I am holy, says the Lord. For when you were the servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. What fruit had you then in those things whereof you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. All you got for that was death. But now being made free from sin and become servants to God, you have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, do you hear that? People take that scripture and they say, oh, look, yes, the wages of sin is death, but God saved me in my sin. Nonsense. Save me from it. I'm made free from it. I carried it. You know, the Pilgrim's Progress has got the picture of a pilgrim at the beginning with a gigantic weight, and he's carrying this gigantic weight, going, who's going to take this burden from me? And then he comes to the cross of Jesus finally, and the burden's taken away, and the sin is removed. It's just a sort of a way of illustrating it. But this burden of sin is so horrendous. And what's sad is people will give their life to Christ Jesus. He'll make them brand new, but they have no teaching, no establishment, don't know what they're doing. They'll go out, be told by people they can continue to sin so grace can abound or some nonsense. And then they'll go out there and they'll sin, and then they've got more burden on their life and they think it's the burden of the Lord. It's the burden of sin. What? How do you get rid of the sin? Repent. It's a good practice, especially, I mean, really, for the rest of your life. Good practice. Father, if there be anything in me, Lord, that I need to repent of, come show me. It's not a bad thing to do. It's a good thing to do. Don't walk around in condemnation thinking, I'm so bad. Don't do that. Begin to rejoice and thank the Lord that you're in Christ Jesus and you have the Holy Ghost and lift up your hands and praise. But I'm going to preach here in a minute. So let's get back to where we're going. But it's important that we understand this. The people have used these scriptures by taking them out of the context in which we're trying to leave them now and not understanding it, because the next chapter is one of the worst ones that they use this for. Verse 1 of chapter 7, know you not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law. I'm talking to you that know the law. I'm going to help you. Why does he have to do this? Because I got the Jew who's self-righteous because he thinks he's keeping the law. I got the Gentile who thinks he has no hope because there's no way for him to enter in. And I've got to conclude them both under sin, and then I've got to bring them both together into one new man, Christ Jesus. Okay? That's what he's doing here. As he's building towards the chapter 8, where it all explodes. But do you not know how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives? For the woman that has a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives. But if the husband is dead, she's loose from the law of her husband. That's the law. So then if, while her husband lives, she's married to another man, she should be called an adulteress. But if her husband is dead, she's free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. So he's illustrating something here. Okay? Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another. You were married to the law, but by the death of Christ, you died. You're free from that now. Okay? That you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. For when we were in the flesh, when we were in the flesh, notice this, when you were in the flesh, this is important to understand. People miss this. When you were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. Remember we said earlier, where he said, you were born in sin, and then you sinned? Because you were born in sin, you sinned, right? In the same way, the motions of sin were in you, and because they were in you, you sinned. You brought forth fruit to death. The wages of sin is death. But now, we're talking about now. We are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, we should serve in newness of spirit and not in oldness of letter. Notice we serve. How do we serve? We yield ourselves instruments unto righteousness. That's how we serve. We don't serve by saying, hey, I can do anything I want now. No, I'm in Christ Jesus and I serve in him, right? What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law, because I would not have known what lust was except the law had said, you will not covet. But sin, taking occasion by that commandment, you will not covet, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. What is concupiscence? Okay, it's all manner of law breaking. Okay? It's all manner of going against the ways of God. That's really what it is. It's rebellion is another way to put it. But it's think of it as the little foxes that spoil the vine. It's the little rebellions that nobody really notices. Okay? It worked in me all manner of concupiscence, for without the law, sin was dead. Sin, there was nothing to make manifest the fact that I was dead in my sin. Nothing showed it. Think of it, there no light was turned on. But the law, I was alive without the law. But when the commandment came, sin saw the commandment, revived in me, and caused me to transgress it. Therefore, I died. And the commandment, which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, it deceived me, and it killed me. Wherefore the law is holy, the commandment is holy, and it's just, and it's good. But it became death to me. Why? Because I had sin. I was in the flesh. I had sin. I was born of Adam. Back to chapter 5. I was born of Adam. Because of Adam's sin, I sinned. And sin passed upon all men, so that all sinned. And this is where I lived. And I didn't really realize how what a mess I was in until the law came and said, you should not covet, and lust rose up in me, and I coveted, and then I died. And it became knowledge to me. Was then that which is good made death? Was the law my death? God forbid. But sin was my death, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. This is back to the argument, I got to conclude everybody under sin. So he's dealing with the Jew. He said, I write to you that know the law. I'm trying to help you guys. You guys that think you're righteous. I'm trying to help you understand. You have a need, same as everybody else. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. People read that and say, well, that's me. Now I'm a carnal, sold under sin. Wrong. The better way to say it, notice, when I'm sold under sin, I'm carnal. Okay? I'm not under sin anymore. Remember, we concluded that already. We're going to conclude it again. For that which I do, I don't want to do. I allow not. What I would, I don't do. What I hate, I do that. If then I do that which I don't want to do, and I consent unto the law that it's good, now then it's no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. People take that and think that's the experience of the believer. No, that's when you were in the flesh and when you were sold under sin. Sin is a cruel, tyrannical taskmaster. Before you were saved. It's tyrannical. It drives you to sin. It is such a burden, and there's no escape from it except for the one, Christ Jesus. It's the only way. He is the only one, the only name whereby men must be saved. You can't be saved any other way. It must be through Christ Jesus. The faith of Christ Jesus, my belief in him, joins together. I become new with him. The old life dies. I become new with him. But so the people take this and say, well, this is the experience of the believer. Nonsense. You can see it very clearly in the context. It's not. Verse 18, I know that in me, in my flesh, dwells no good thing. For to will, I want to do good. To will is present with me. But how to perform that which is good, I cannot find a way. Wow, that's a terrible place to be. For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. Now, if I do what I don't want to do, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members. It's warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? That's a horrible place to be. I thank God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Stop there for a second. Who's going to deliver me? Jesus Christ, our Lord. He delivers me. He delivered me from sin. He delivered me from this horrible state. And delivered. But then Paul says this. So then, understand. With the mind, I serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. What's he saying? He's concluding his argument in chapter 7. His argument was to help the Jew to understand, as he set up here earlier, in my mind and in my will, I want to do what's good, but I can't do it. So in my mind, I'm trying to keep the law of God, but in my flesh, there's this power of sin that I cannot escape from. Then he says this, chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now, we're back to now. Remember we had a now earlier? Now, no condemnation. That's condemnation. I want to do good and I can't. I don't want to do evil, but I do. That's condemnation. That's a horrible feeling. I'm trying to go to the right, but I'm being pulled to the left. That's a horrible place, right? There is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who don't walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Remember he said, when we were in the flesh, this is what we were like. Now we're in the Spirit. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Notice in verse 21 of chapter 7, it said, I find a law. That's the law of sin and death. There's a law in my members that sin is there and it keeps causing me to transgress, therefore bringing forth fruit unto death. But now, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus made me free from that law of sin and death. Now, it can't be more clear. How do people miss this? I remember vividly sitting in my dorm room in college. I'm just learning these things. And I got a guy who's still a preacher in a church somewhere else in the country looking at me, telling me, quoting Romans 7:7, look, end of the discussion. It's no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. Done. Walk away. That's a horrible place to live. Absolutely horrible. And you're going to teach people that? Lead them in that? Build a big church on that? Have fun. That's horrible. I've been made free from that law. I found then a law working in my members. I've been made free from that law. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
For what the law could not do, the law of God, in that it was weak through the flesh, because there was this law in my flesh that caused me to transgress the law of God, and the law of God could come and point out the sin, but it couldn't do anything to take it away. God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Condemned it. Said, I don't have any sin in my flesh. His testimony was he pleased God. His testimony was he never transgressed. That the righteousness, verse 4, of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This is the summary of everything that we've talked about up to now. This is it. Here we are. Righteousness has been given. We've heard the testimony over and over. The righteousness we've received in every chapter practically. But here's the summary of it. The righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us because we don't walk after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And now the rest of chapter 8 is going to talk to us about how to do that. That's what Pastor Mark spent all those hours talking about. And just the life of the Spirit. And it's what we do here more than anything else is encourage people in the Word of God of how to walk in the Spirit, how to do it, and how walking in the Spirit, that grace that we've received and the power of God that we've received fills us and causes all these good things to happen. Now, they that are after the flesh, they mind the things of the flesh. But they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded, to be earthly minded, to be fleshly minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Remember back there we said, made a big emphasis, we receive peace through Jesus Christ, peace with God through Jesus Christ our Lord? Well, here's where it is, right here. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. It's the same thing. Because the carnal mind is at enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, and it cannot be. Neither indeed can it be. It just cannot be. There is a law in the flesh that when you live in the flesh, there's a law that will make you transgress. But in the Spirit, not so. So then they that are in the flesh, they cannot please God. Wow. But you are not in the flesh, but you're in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Remember earlier when he said, and the Holy Ghost is shed abroad in our heart. You receive the Spirit of God, the Spirit of God that dwells in you. Now, if any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he doesn't belong to Christ. Because remember, we concluded that everybody gets brought into one new man, one person, Jesus Christ. I stand before God, Jesus Christ. Not little Christ, not part Christ, not shadow of Christ. I am in him. Therefore, I stand before God as Jesus Christ. Isn't that's remarkable. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you will die. But if ye through the Spirit do put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Wow. For if you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. He's my Father. That's why Jesus said, you don't have to ask me anything. You ask my Father in my name and he will give it to you. He's your Father. That relationship, that knowledge of God, of how much we have a relationship with the Father, of Father and Son, has been so fought against. I mean, God has been painted to be some mean old guy, separate from people, far off in the distance, not caring. Everything that people could paint God as, it has tried to be done. But he is a loving Father. A loving Father. He does what Jason's doing over there. He holds the baby. He'll take us in his arms and hold us. He'll comfort us. He'll take care of our needs. That's the Father. That's the heart of the Father. But our culture teaches us different. And many times we don't understand how many concepts of God we have that are mistaken. I've learned over the years many things that were just in my spirit, they're in my thinking, they're in my memory of how I viewed that relationship that were wrong. And the only way to think different about it is to think according to the Word of God and stop judging God by your understanding and start hearing what He says and believing what He says. Even as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness, when you believe God and you believe what He says, now you'll do these things. It's amazing. So, if you live after the flesh, you die, verse 13. But if you through the Spirit do put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption or sonship, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together, implying together with him, because we're all in him. When Jesus receives glory, we're receiving the same glory with him, because we're part of him. Everything that we are is him. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time, they're not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Because remember earlier he said, we also glory in tribulations? He says, the sufferings of this present world, they're nothing. Nothing compared to the glory. For the earnest expectation of the creation waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature, the creation, was made subject to vanity. When? When Adam sinned. Remember what Adam was ruling over? The earth. When he sinned, guess what got caught up in all of it? The earth. Okay? The creation. It was made subject to vanity. You want to know about vanity? Just go read Ecclesiastes. I'll tell you all about it. Not willingly, but by reason of him who subjected the same, there's that word again, in hope. God said to Adam, Adam sinned. Did God cast him away? No, but he subjected him to death. Why? In hope of what? A resurrection. There's no hope, but there's a resurrection. There is no other way, because the wages of sin was death, and death was death. The only way to defeat that was to conquer death and raise from the dead in a new life, because the old life was ruined. Could not, Adam's life was ruined. He even recognized that, so he went and hid himself. His life was ruined because of his sin, right? But God subjected the entire creation to a curse. In what? In hope. God knew his plan, his purpose, and he was going to bring it to pass, and it was going to take a resurrection to do it. He's going to bring a resurrection. Because the creation itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption unto the glorious liberty of the children of God, where there'll be no more sin. For we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. And not only, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. This fleshly body still decays. It's still subjected to death, but it's in hope. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen isn't hope anymore. If I'm hoping to have a child someday, I'm hoping. I'm waiting in full expectation. Then the child's born. Now I'm no more hoping for it. I got it. Right? It's there. So that's what he's talking about. Expectation is expectation. What expectation can I know I receive? The Word of God. Everything the Word of God says is mine. I know it's mine because God testified it's mine. Just as he said to Abraham, you're going to be the father of many nations. Abraham knew it was true. We're saved by hope. Hope that is seen is not hope. What a man sees, why are you hoping for it? But if we hope for what we do not see, then we with patience wait for it. What's he talking about? The resurrection of the body. He's not talking about redemption from sin. We got that already. He's talking about the resurrection of the body. I'm still in expectation that this flesh will die and be resurrected. whether through the grave or through the rapture or the catching away or however it be, this is going to be resurrected and a glorified body is going to take its place. Praise the Lord. That'll be good. Likewise, in the same manner, the Spirit helps our infirmities. For we don't know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Look, it's all about the Holy Ghost. It said earlier, we receive the Holy Ghost, the grace that we've been given. We've been given the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost is the one who now comes and leads us into all the truth of all these things and helps us to understand that we're in Christ Jesus and then causes us to do all the righteous things that he wants us to do. And we know that all things work together to good, for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Who's the first one that went that way? Jesus. Okay. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. How? Because we're all in Jesus. The emphasis, the important point, the thing you got to get, you're in him. Your life is his. You're not your own. You've been bought with a price. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? I mean, if he spared not his own Son to get us to this place, how is he not going to give us everything? Well, I'll tell you, he gave us the Holy Ghost. He pretty much gave us everything. Right? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ that died. Yea, rather is risen again, even more importantly, who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. That's Psalms 44:22. Nay, in all these things, what things? Being accounted as sheep for the slaughter, nakedness, persecution, famine, tribulation, peril, sword. In all these things, we are more than conquerors for him that loved us. Remember the scripture? Don't resist the evil, but do good and heap coals of fire upon its head, right? What's going on here? We're more than conquerors. They may kill me, but I'm still more than a conqueror because I'm going to stand in the Spirit and I'm going to love. You know, you love them. You lay down your life, just even as Jesus did. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wow, that's amazing. I say the truth in Christ. I do not lie. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. Uh-oh. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertains the adoption and the glory and the covenants, the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom is concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen. Notice what's happening now. We're back to that argument. What advantage then has the Jew? We're back to the argument. I speak to them that are under the law. What happens here is he comes to these glorious conclusions. But then he's got to go back and he's got to bring in and help them to understand that this is for you too. This is about you too. Because, I mean, there's a lot of things that happen and people fighting against them, but he's telling us, I want Israel to be saved. And that's what he's going to talk about here. Just like, what advantage is there to be a Jew? Well, there's a lot of advantage to grow up in a household filled with the Word of God. And even today, you may not be a Jew, but if you grow up in a household filled with the Word of God, that's an advantage, right? Okay. Verse 6, not as though the word of God has not taken effect, for they're not all Israel which are of Israel, because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And that's Genesis 21:12, Hebrews 11:18. If you're writing it down. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of the promise, that at that time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. That's Genesis 18:10. He's telling us this. So he's saying, look, Jew is a genetic, fleshly, earthly designation. In Christ, there is no Jew or Gentile. But he's saying, look, we got to deal with something here. The Jews were God's covenant people, and yet they have not believed on Jesus. And he said earlier, shall their unbelief make the faith of God of no effect? God forbid. So he's going to talk about this now. And this is it's important. You'll get to the conclusion. And not only this, but when Rebekah had conceived by one, even our father Isaac, for the children, they were not yet born. They had done no good or evil of their own, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of the one who calls. It was said unto her, and that was said in Genesis 25:21, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Wow. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Is the question. God forbid. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. That's Exodus 33:19. So then it is not of him that wills, nor of him that runs, but of God that shows mercy. Remember, we said he had to conclude everybody under sin so they could understand they had to receive the justification by faith. In the same way, he's telling them, look, you need to understand something. I'm doing this. It's me. I'm choosing this so that you will understand it's not of your will or not of what you do, but it's of me. It shows mercy. For the scripture says unto Pharaoh, and who is Pharaoh? Exodus 9:16. Even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore has he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardens. So does this mean that God chooses some of us to be saved and some of us not to be? People have taken that and said that. They have used this to say that there is a salvation for certain people but not for others. And he chooses some to bless and some to harden. That's not what he says. And we're going to hear Paul's argument. Says this, thou wilt say unto me, why doth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? I mean, well then why does he have fault with me? It's not my fault. I'm not resisting his will. Nay, but O man, who are you that replies against God? Shall the thing form say to him that formed it, why have you made me this way? Has not the potter power over the clay of the same lump to make one vessel to honor and another to dishonor? What if God, willing to show his wrath? Now here's the argument, listen to this. God wants to show us his wrath. The same way the law came to show us what sin was working in the fleshly members. And he wants to make his power known. He endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. When God says, I will have mercy in whom I have mercy and whom he wills, he hardens. He's dealing with a vessel under wrath. And he endures that vessel in order for the purpose to make his power known. It's not that he made that vessel to be that way. It chose to be that way. Remember chapter 1? They, knowing God, refused to acknowledge him as God, and they gave themselves over to hardness, right? So God endures with long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction, that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had afore prepared unto glory. He wants us to see the difference. It's not that he chose somebody to be a vessel of wrath, but they chose to be a vessel of wrath, and he endures that vessel of wrath to show the difference. That's what he's talking about. Even us whom he has called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. As he also says in Hosea 2:23, I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which was not beloved. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, you are not my people, there shall be called the children of the living God. Isaiah in 10:22 also cries concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because a short work will the Lord make upon the earth. And as Isaiah said before, it's Isaiah 1:9, except the Lord of Sabbath had left us a seed, we had been as Sodom and we had been like unto Gomorrah. I mean, notice that when God wiped out Israel, he wiped them out down to there was just a remnant, just a little bit. What should we say then? What do we say? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. Justification by faith being the theme again. Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Wherefore? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone. As is written, that's Isaiah 8:14 and Isaiah 28:16, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and rock of offense, and whosoever believes on him shall not be ashamed or shall not make haste. What is the point of this chapter? The point of this chapter is people are saying, well, you know, God makes all these statements, I will have mercy and whom I have mercy. Is it really for everybody? Yeah, it's really for everybody. It's anybody who will call. It's anybody who will believe. But God, in order to testify, that's why he says, look, he chose Esau, Jacob and Esau, and they had never done anything. They were still in their mother's womb. He said, I chose that the elder will serve the younger. It's God chose that, so that his purpose. You might understand, it's of God who does this. There is no righteousness you will obtain on your own. The testimony is this, not that God chooses some people to save and some not. The testimony is that God chooses to show you and make clear to you that the only person who could make this salvation was him. The only way you can get life is in Christ Jesus. The only way you can receive from God is the way that he has prescribed, so that many that have been offenders could all be made one in one life, Christ Jesus. All right, so that finishes 9. We are now in chapter 10. Paul's letter to us, written to the Romans, still speaks to us. Is everybody back?
One more time.
Looks like? Okay. It's getting hot. Chapter 10, verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record. They have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they... remember this in Romans 1:17 where it said, the righteousness of God revealed, the just shall live by faith, right? Remember Romans 3:21 said, the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, witnessed by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God which is by the faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that have believed, for there's no difference. They, Israel, being ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Have you submitted yourself to the righteousness of God? Yes, that's what I received. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. For Moses describes the righteousness of the law. It's in Leviticus 18:5. The man that does those things will live by them. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks this way. Don't say in your heart, who shall ascend to heaven to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what does it say? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. Pastor Mark was talking this week a couple different times about he put his word in my mouth, right? Right here. That if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart man believes to righteousness, with the mouth confession is made to salvation. Believe me, there's power in speaking it. There's power in saying it. There's power in testifying of it. We need to do these things. I was a very silent person for many years. I didn't talk about such things. Didn't argue about such things. Didn't do anything. I just left it alone. I'm not saying we should argue. That's not what I mean. But I just didn't say anything. God taught me where I was wrong in the fact that I needed to confess with my mouth. I needed to confess it, even if it was just between him and me. This, Lord, I believe. Yes, Lord, I know. There's a power in confession. Okay? It says this. May you believe in your heart to righteousness. Not to unrighteousness, to righteousness. And you confess your mouth. From your mouth, mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, Isaiah 28:16 and Isaiah 49:23, whosoever believes on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Open your mouth. Lord, help. It's a great prayer. You'll be saved. How then shall they call on him whom they haven't believed? You are not going to call on somebody you don't even believe is there. You're not going to call on someone you've not believed on. Look, the mouth confession comes because you've received and you believe from the heart what was delivered to you. You believed it, so you confessed it with your mouth, right? You can't confess on him whom you not believe. How shall they believe in him whom they've not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written in Isaiah 52:7, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Remember he said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of God. I'm not ashamed of the good news of God. We bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. That's the difference. So now, at one time, there was a dichotomy between the Jew and the Gentile. Now it's between the obedient and the disobedient, simply. For Isaiah said, Lord, who's believed our report? That's 53:1. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Remember the theme here, justification by faith, right? Faith comes, you hear it proclaimed, and you obey it. That's what it means. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, truly, their sound went into all the earth and their words unto the end of the world. And I say, did not Israel know? First Moses said, where did Moses say this? He said it in Deuteronomy 32:21. I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. And Isaiah was very bold in 65:1-2 and said, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he said in Isaiah 65:2, all day long have I stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. They've heard, they did not obey. They've heard, they did not believe, right? I say then, has God cast his people away? Is that the conclusion then? God forbid. I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not cast away his people, which he foreknew. Do you not understand that the scripture says of Elias, how he makes intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they've killed thy prophets and dig down their altars, and I am alone, I am left alone, and they seek my life. That was 1 Kings 19:10. But what says the answer of God unto him later in the chapter? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so then, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. He's going, look, it's one or the other. It's not the works of the law. It's the grace that God gives us. What then? Israel has not obtained what he's seeking for, but the election has obtained it. So the rest were blinded. Who are the elect? Those who believe. God has mercy on those who believe, and those who refuse, he hardens. That's what happens. According as it is written in Isaiah 29:10, God has given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see and ears they should not hear unto this day. And David said in 69:22-23 of Psalms, let their table be made a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see and bow down their back alway. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? Similar to, has he cast them away? God forbid. But rather through their fall, salvation has come unto the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? Won't it be wonderful if they all believed? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. If by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are my flesh, and might save some of them. For if the casting away of them is the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? For if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy. And if the root be holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches are broken off, and you, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches. But if you boast, you don't bear the root. The root bears you. Remember, it's all about what God does, not about what you do. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and you stand by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, lest he also spare not you. You hear that? Belief. They were justified by faith because they believed God and he was counted to him for righteousness. We receive because we believe. And because we believe, we testify. Right? Behold, verse 22, therefore the goodness and the severity of God on them which fell, severity. But toward thee, goodness, if you continue in his goodness. Otherwise, you also shall be cut off. People say all the time, well, you can't be saved and then lose your salvation. Sounds pretty lost to me. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. Amazing. If you were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, Isaiah 59:20-21, Isaiah 27:9. There shall come out of Sion the deliverer, and turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. When Ezekiel testifies of I will make a covenant in those days, not after the covenant they made with your fathers, but I will write my law in your hearts, he's testifying to the Jew. So he's writing to. It just so happens it's also for all those of us who, like Abraham, believe. It's for everybody, Jew and Gentile. But there's also going to be a fulfillment in the last day, because the Jews are going to come back. Verse 28, as concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. For the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. For as in ye in time past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief, even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy. For God has concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy upon all. God concluded us all under sin, that he might justify all who believe. Okay? Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, his ways past finding out. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has first given to him and shall be recompensed unto him again? You know, who does God owe anything? For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. So he had to deal with the concept of Israel. This is, you know, it's end time prophecy. It's purposes of God not being changed. But the faith of Abraham is available to whosoever will believe. It was available to his descendants at all times. That same faith. The just live by faith in David's day. They live by faith in the divided kingdom day. They live by faith in Babylon when they were in captivity. They live by faith when they came back. That's how you live. It's by faith. Those that chose to live by faith received in their life the blessing of God. Those that did not, did not. It's that simple. Chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed. 1 Peter 1:14 says the same thing. By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And that renewing of your mind, Pastor Mark spent a lot of time talking about, thinking different about yourself. Really believing the word of God above everything that testifies against it. Just like Abraham, who did not consider his body now dead, and the fact that his wife's womb was barren. He didn't consider that. He considered the promise of God. In the same way, he's telling you, think differently. Don't judge after the seeing of your eye or the hearing of your ear. Jesus said, I don't judge that way. I judge righteously. How do I judge? By the word of God. This is the faith that we believe, which is what we testify of. Titus 3:5 says the same thing, not by works of righteousness which you've done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. It's the renewing of your mind. You begin to think differently. You begin to see things the way God sees them and not the way you judge them by your earthly judgment. This is what he says, knowing that all of this is true, knowing that God has done all this for you, I beseech you, brethren, begin to live, think, act, walk differently. He did not save us to leave us where we were. He saved us to bring us into the life of Christ Jesus. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy, according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teaches on teaching, or he that exhorts on exhortation, he that gives, let him do it with simplicity, he that rules with diligence, he that shows mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. In other words, don't use, another place says, don't use love as a cloak for maliciousness. You know, don't give somebody an outward show of love to steal from them with your other hand. Okay? Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. Don't be slothful in business. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice. Weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Don't be wise in your own conceits. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men, recognizing that some people choose not to live peaceably with you. So if it's possible, live peaceably with everybody. But if they choose not, sometimes there's nothing you can do. Dearly beloved, don't avenge yourself, but give place unto wrath. For it is written, that's Isaiah 63:4, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he thirsts, give him drink. For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Don't be overcome of evil. Overcome evil with good. That's who we, Jew and Gentile, all who believe, all who receive the faith, all who live in Jesus, supposed to do what Jesus did. Do you know he did all these things? This is what Jesus did. This is how he lived. Verse 1 of chapter 13, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. There's no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resists the power, resists the ordinance of God, and they that resist are received to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and you will have praise of the same. What's he talking about? As much as you can, without conflicting against the things that God demanded that you do, submit yourself to the laws of the nation in which you reside. Don't go out breaking them for the sake of breaking them. Don't resist them. Submit to them. It's meant to keep things orderly. Now, when they tell you to call evil good and good evil, you don't have to do that. It's not what we're talking about. God's not saying that, you know, well, they told me I had to do this evil thing, so I have to do it. Nonsense. But as much as you can, do that. Verse 4, he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he bears not the sword in vain. He is the minister of God, a revenger, to execute wrath upon him that does evil. Why? Because God allows and endures vessels of wrath for the purpose of bringing people to an understanding there's a right and there's a wrong. I mean, we just studied all that. Wherefore, you must needs be subject not only for wrath, but for conscience sake. For this cause pay ye tribute also. They are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. He says do it. That's why Jesus said, render to Caesar things that are Caesar's, render to God things that are God's. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loves another has fulfilled the law. For this, you will not commit adultery, you will not kill, you will not steal, you will not bear false witness, you will not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, love your neighbor as yourself. Love works no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. That's what we're supposed to do. Jesus told us to do that. And he said, take up your cross and follow me. Hate your life in this world. He told us to forsake father and mother, houses and lands. He told us not to give any thought and be anxious about what we're going to eat, what we're going to wear, and where we're going to live, but to seek the kingdom of God. It's the same thing. Do you understand that? Paul's just reiterating what Jesus said. It's a great way to go. Chapter 14, verse 1, him that is weak in the faith, receive you, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believes he can eat all things, another who is weak eats only vegetables, eats only herbs. Let not him that eats despise the one that doesn't eat, and don't let the one that eats not judge him that eats, for God received him. In other words, these are not the things that dichotomize us. Okay, they're not what make us separate. We shouldn't allow these things to separate us. Well, in my church, we eat meat, but in their church, they only eat vegetables. Therefore, we're not them. We're not of them. They're not of us. If that's what's separating you, you got real problems. Okay? That's not what separates us. Okay? That's what he's basically saying. Verse 4, who are you that judges another man's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Yea, he will be held up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. That's me. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regards the day regards it to the Lord. He that regards not the day to the Lord, he does not regard it. He that eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. He that does not eat to the Lord, he does not eat and gives God thanks. For none of us lives to himself, and no man dies to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. Some men, two preachers get taken from the street for preaching the gospel, thrown in prison. One dies, one comes out to great glory. One died unto the Lord and one didn't. John, the beloved disciple, lived longer than any other disciple, and his brother was the first one to get martyred. Who's to say? We don't judge according to those things. One died unto the Lord and one lived unto the Lord. He said to Peter, what is that to you? What is it to you? Whether this one lives or this one dies or whatever, you do what God called you to do. Verse 9, to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and living. But why dost thou judge thy brother? And why do you set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. Understand this. The judgment seat of Christ is judgment for those who believe. Everything we're talking about here is for believers. Notice the believer who eats and the believer who doesn't. The believer who regards the day and the believer who doesn't. It's still a believer. To understand. What he's trying to say here, these things should not divide us in any way, shape, or form. They do not divide us. Be persuaded in your own mind what's right for you, what's right before God, and give God thanks. And if God shows you differently, then change. Absolutely. Chapter 14, verse 12. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus, there's nothing unclean of itself. Now, is murder unclean? Yes. What's he talking about? Let's remember. He's basically talking about food and regarding days. Okay? That's what he's talking about. Nothing unclean of itself. But to him that esteems anything to be unclean, to him it's unclean. I don't want to eat pork? Fine. Don't make me. But if I do, don't bother me. It's really another way to say this. Right? But if thy brother be grieved with your meat, chapter 14, verse 15, now walkest thou not charitably. Don't destroy him with your meat for whom Christ died. Let not then your good be evil spoken of, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. But, you know, if I got a brother who's really going to be offended because I got pork at the table, I'm not going to serve it. I don't need it. It's not important. Let's try not to cause divisions over things that don't matter. That's really what he's talking about. But likewise, I shouldn't be offended when somebody does something that I don't think I should. But we're not talking about sin here. I need to emphasize that again. We're not talking about sin. We've already concluded all of a sudden about sin. Shall we continue in sin? No! No, absolutely not. But these things, these are, you know, struggles that people have over things that don't matter. So let's be charitable to one another and let's work with one another and come to a place where we're not judging one another in these things. Okay? Verse 17, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness. That matters. Remember, we got all that righteousness. We filled up peace. Remember, we have peace with God and joy in the Holy Ghost. Absolutely. For he that is in these things serves Christ. He that in these things serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved of men. Yeah. righteousness, peace, and joy. That let's emphasize. So when you come in here and you look sorrowful and the pastor says, stop looking sorrowful, get filled with joy, you go, well, you're not supposed to be judging me. Look, that isn't what we're talking about here. He didn't come in and say, did you have bacon for breakfast? All you had bacon for breakfast, go to the back of the room. He didn't do that. But if you're not in righteousness, if you're not in peace and you're not in joy, then you need to be judged by those that have the rule over you so that you can get out of that mess and get into the righteousness, the peace, and the joy. Do you see the difference?
Yes, yes.
But it's amazing. People come in, well, you're judging me. Yeah, because you're living in sorrow and sin. You need to get out of it. But look, it's much better over here. Come over here. Yeah, but you're judging me. Anyway, this is the difference. For he that in these things serves Christ, verse 18, is acceptable to God and approved to men. Let us therefore follow after the things that make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. For meat destroy not the work of God. Just, it's not worth arguing over meat. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for that man who eats with an offense. If he feels like, if I'm going to create an offense, I'm going to take my bacon and get in your face and eat it and go, it's okay for me. That's offensive. You don't need to do that, right? It is good neither to eat flesh nor to drink wine nor anything whereby your brother stumbles or is offended or is made weak. Wow. Isn't that impressive? Do you have faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemns not himself in the things which he allows. And he that doubts is damned if he eat because he eats not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. If you're allowing something in your life that God told you was wrong, you're in trouble. But it wasn't given to you to go around beating up your brother over. Just not. Not these things. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. We believe God, it's counted to us for righteousness. I believe God. I'm going to eat my food and believe God that he provided it for me, and I'm blessed with it. But if I look at it and think, God told me not to do this anymore, and I go against that, well, then it's a problem for me because I'm not eating in faith, not believing that God provided this for me. I'm transgressing what he told me to do. Chapter 15, verse 1. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak and not to please ourselves. Oh, my. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. For even Christ pleased not himself. But as it is written, Psalm 69, 9. It's also in John 5, 30. The reproaches of them that reproached thee fell on me. He didn't please himself. He pleased the one who sent him. He said, Lord, they reproached you by reproaching me because I'm your servant. I'm doing what you told me to do, saying what you told me to say. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Back to that hope thing. We have hope. We have great hope. The day is coming. Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore receive ye one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. We're back to this Jew-Gentile thing. Jesus was of the Jews. He was of the circumcision. He was a minister of the word of God. He quoted from what we call the Old Testament over and over, and he confirmed the promises that were made to the fathers. That's what he came to do. And that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, and that's in Psalms 18, 49, for this cause I will confess to thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. And again he says, Deuteronomy 32, 43, rejoice ye Gentiles with his people. And again, Psalms 171, praise the Lord all ye Gentiles and laud him all ye people. And again, Isaiah says in Isaiah 11, 1, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles, In him shall the Gentiles trust. What is he saying? It's not only for the Jew,
it's also for the Gentile.
Now, we're back to a now. I've heard a bunch of nows. Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, and that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. We abound in the knowledge of all that God has fulfilled and will fulfill in the Holy Ghost. I have been made alive in Christ Jesus, and it's manifested by the Holy Ghost, and he brings to me the hope that one day this body will be resurrected and glorified by the Holy Ghost. I mean, it's all in that. Everything is in that. Do you notice? I want you to notice something. There's been no specific teaching here where we start dichotomizing salvation from the Holy Ghost. They're all together. It's all one. It was never meant to be. We start making these little dividing lines. Well, those people that Paul ministered to hadn't heard of the Holy Ghost and they were saved. Yeah, you can be saved and not be baptized in the Holy Ghost. But believe me, it's all one. It's all the same. You want to have it all. It's all been given. You know, some people, it may be stretched out a bit in their perceptions of life. But it's really all one. Paul doesn't make these big distinctions between that, because in salvation, there's the Holy Ghost. I mean, it just goes with it. When Paul got saved, he got the Holy Ghost. He was filled with the Holy Ghost. I mean, it just happened. When the Gentiles heard the word of God and believed on Jesus, they got the Holy Ghost. They go together. But, you know, people say, well, it doesn't specifically say, it's all over, because they're just together, you know? If I get Christopher up here, I get his Bible and his shirt, his pants and his shoes with him. It all part of the same. It all comes, right? So the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Let me take you one more thing back to hope. Remember Abraham. Against hope, he believed in hope. He believed the promise of God. Notice Jesus confirmed the promises. He believed the promise of God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. When it says here that you abound in hope, it's really believe the promises of God and don't judge after what you see, what you hear, what you sense with your five senses. Believe the word of God through the power of the Holy Ghost. He's going to come to strengthen you, come to comfort you, come to give you the life of Christ Jesus. That's what he comes to do. He comes to manifest that hope of the life of Christ Jesus that you've been given. He reveals him. And that place where you've been taken from being one of those many and brought into that one new man, Christ Jesus, the Holy Ghost is the seal of that. He shows that we have that. It's the manifestation of what we have. And I myself, Paul says, am persuaded of you, my brethren, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. Nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind because of the grace that is given to me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified, set apart by the Holy Ghost. I have therefore whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has not wrought by me to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed. What was wrought by him? Through mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. This is how he did it. We heard earlier, the power of God. This is a reiteration. The power of God comes. Yea, so have I strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation, but as it is written, and that's in Isaiah 52:15, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand. For which cause also I have been much hindered from coming to you, But now, having no more place in these parts, and having great desire these many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey unto Spain, I will come to you, for I trust to see you in my journey, and be brought on my way thitherward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints. For it has pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the four poor saints which are at Jerusalem. It has pleased them truly, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles have been made partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. When therefore I have performed this and have sealed to them this fruit, I will come by you unto Spain. He's talking about, he said it in another place where he said, I'm going to take what you guys have contributed and how you've made yourselves poor. I'm going to take that contribution and you're going to receive fruit unto holiness and eternal life, right? And so he says it again here in a different context. I am sure that when I come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that you strive together with me in your prayers to God for me, that I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service, which I have for Jerusalem, may be accepted of the saints, that I may come unto you with joy by the will of God, and may with you be refreshed. Now the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Now, excuse me. Notice, he eventually made it, but he made it as a prisoner. He went to Jerusalem, he was received, they asked him to do a couple things, but there were some people who did not receive him, and he was eventually jailed, and he appealed to Caesar and was sent to Rome that way. But he got there through many tribulations and trials. When we talk about tribulations and trials, that's really what's being talked about. You're doing the work of the ministry. You're doing the work of Jesus Christ. You're doing the work God gave you to do. And there's oppositions, and there are trials, and there are struggles, and there are people who are against you, and people who speak evil of you, and things. It doesn't matter. You can rejoice regardless. You believe in God. One is not better than another because he was the martyr versus the one who lived the longest, as we said earlier. Not the point. Rejoice in tribulations. That's what Paul's always talking about. He talks about, I rejoice in my tribulations. I don't rejoice in my sin. I don't rejoice in my mistakes. I don't rejoice in the things I've done wrong. I'm rejoicing in tribulation. And this is what he means. But we know here where he's writing to them saying, hey, I mean to go to Judea, and then my intention is to go to Spain, and on my way to Spain, I'm passing through Rome. Happy to come see you. It just took a major detour. And how he got there. Chapter 16, verse 1, I commend unto you, you know, one of the things I thought about doing is, it just, he wrote to some specific people here to commend unto them. But, you know, you can just put your own name in there. You know, I commend unto you Catherine, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at San Diego, that you receive her in the Lord has become saints, and that you assist her in whatsoever business she has need of you, for she has been a succorer of many and of myself also. Greet Grayson, Stuart, my helpers in Christ Jesus, who laid down my life, laid down their own necks, and to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Likewise, greet the church that's in their house. Salute my well-beloved Paul, who is the first fruits of Achaia unto Christ. Greet, greet KC, who bestowed much labor on us. Salute Christopher and Frank, and it goes on, my kinsmen, my fellow prisoners, who are of note among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. And then he greets Amplius, my beloved in the Lord. Salute Urbane, our helper in Christ, and Stachys, my beloved. Salute Apollos, unproved in Christ. Salute them which are of Aristobulus' household. Salute Herodian, my kinsmen. Greet them that be of the household of Narcissus, which are in the Lord. Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord. Salute Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Salute Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermas, Petrobus, Hermes, and the brethren which are with them. Salute Philologus, and Julia, Nereus, and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints which are with them. Salute one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ salute you. So he was calling out these people, just talking about them. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you've learned, and avoid them. Wow. Just avoid them. Divisions are bad. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly or their own lusts, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. For your obedience is come abroad unto all men. I am glad, therefore, on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen again. Says it again. Timotheus, my workfellow, and Lucius and Jason and Sosipater, my kinsmen, salute you. I, Tertius, who wrote this epistle, salute you in the Lord. What does that mean, he wrote it? It means that Paul was dictating. He was writing. Gaius, mine host, and of the whole church, salute you. Erastus, the chamberlain of the city, salute you. And Quartus, a brother, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Third amen. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. It's the same thing was in chapter 1, obedience of faith. When you believe, you obey. When you hear, you obey. This is key to faith. It's not faith if you're not obeying what is said. Abraham obeyed. God said, get out of your country, leave your kinsmen, and go over here. Abraham did it. He did what God told him to do. God gave him a promise. Abraham believed the promise. Obedience, faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. And we made it through 2 minutes to 12. So I want to emphasize something in summary. And I hope that you heard all this. There's an argument where Paul concludes everybody, Jew and Gentile, under sin. He makes it very clear. He's dealing with the fact that the Jew felt he didn't need to be convinced of sin because he felt he was righteous because he kept the law. So Paul makes very impassioned and detailed arguments to conclude everybody's under sin. There's none righteous, no, not one. But that is not the gospel. That is where you start. Then he makes it very clear that the gospel is you've been justified by faith, the same way Abraham was. You've been brought into this life. And then in chapter 5, he said, look, it's not about you. It's about Christ Jesus. And you get to leave your old life and come into the newness of life. And now your whole life is in him. It could never be outside of him. And then he begins to deal with questions and the craziness of people saying, what are you trying to say? That if God did it all, it doesn't matter what we did. No, shall we that continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. No, 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 no. And 1,000 times, no. You know that you yield yourselves, whoever you yield yourself, you are the weapon of who you yield yourself. You're a servant of who you yield yourself. Choose to yield yourself to God. By the power that is given you, the power of the Holy Ghost, the power of grace. Chapter 7, he deals with them that are in the flesh, that are under the law. Doesn't apply to you and me. It may have applied to us before, but doesn't apply now. Sadly, I think it applies to a lot of people that call themselves Christians and go to church. That's where they live because they misunderstand. There is therefore now no condemnation. There is no law of sin and death in me anymore because I died. Once I died, it was over. I died just as Jesus. I died unto sin. He died unto sin once. I die with him. I'm baptized into his death, right? Now, because of that, I have the law of the Spirit instead of the law of sin and death. It's very clear. And now, by the Holy Ghost, I live this life of the Spirit. And I learn to walk in the Spirit. And I'm growing in the grace of God. It's not something that I understand everything of how to do. So I mark them that go before me and that have followed on to know the Lord, and I follow after them. And when they tell me to lift my hands, and when they tell me to pray, and when they tell me to rejoice, and when they tell me to give thanks, I obey, because my faith is the obedience of faith. And I believe, and therefore I know it's true, and therefore I follow after them, that I too might obtain like precious faith. That's what it's all about. Then he goes into his argument about the last days and about Israel and about an understanding that God is not just willy-nilly casting people off and deciding who's going to be saved or not according to their works. No, he chose everybody. He predestinated in Christ Jesus that everybody would be part of that same life. Everybody is in Jesus, one man. Another place that says he made of himself of two, one new man. Galatians. Do you know the number? It's in Galatians, I believe. So he took, made himself of one new man. This is the gospel. This is what we preach. This is what Jesus did. That's the fundamental thing. And now that we are in the Spirit, now that we've been set free from sin, did you find it? Galatians 3:28. Now that we are in the Spirit, now that we've been set free from the bondage of sin, now that there's no more condemnation, now that we've been given the life of God, the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, the wonders of the first fruits of all that God has given unto us, how shall we then live? And he tells us how to live, what to do, what not to do. And then he tells us not to be divided by stupid things. Don't be divided by meats and diverse washings and days and times. And years. Just don't be divided by these things. Don't allow it to divide you. But he's not talking about sin. We already concluded sin was over. And then he finishes off his last statement, obedience to the faith. So the theme of Romans from beginning to end is obedience to the faith, the just live by faith. We believe God, counted to us for righteousness. And because of that, we now have the life of God coursing through us, filling us with everything that's of God. Amen. So you get it. Amen. Does anybody have a specific question that we should try to answer before we conclude? Specific, pointed. I know it's so much, but if there's not, then we are over, we're done. Where does that fit in? Whosoever wills? She's asking, how does whosoever will? God is not willing that any should perish. And whosoever will can come into life, because what do they have to do? They have to believe God and receive from him the righteousness that is of faith. Anybody, Jew, Gentile, Scythian, barbarian, bond, free, far away, near, color of skin, none of it matters. What matters is, do you believe the promise of God? And how should they hear if we don't go preach? Yeah. And how should we preach if we don't have a word to preach and we're not called? Well, we need to receive from God. So what do? We ask him to send forth laborers into his harvest. We pray the prayer he asked us to pray. We be obedient to the faith. So we pray that prayer, send forth laborers. And it usually begins with me. Yeah. Laborers. To preach, here's the word of salvation. Jesus came to save sinners, of whom I was at first, Paul said. He was not the worst sinner. He was at first a sinner. Then he was made righteous. Amen. Amen. Bless you all.